Kevin Maxwell lives in a cottage in Kmusferna, in the West Highlands in Scotland. When his dog, Johnny, died, he was too sad to think of keeping a dog again. What did he keep as a pet, then?
In 1956, I visited Iraq. I saw many otters there. And I thought, I should keep an otter, instead of a dog. My house, in Kmusferna, is ringed by water at a short distance from the door, so it would be a suitable spot to keep an otter.
Otters love playing with water. That is why, he thought, that his house, that is surrounded by water, will be a suitable place for the experiment.
When I casually mentioned this to a friend, he replied,
"You should better get one from Tigris marshes. For there, they are as common as mosquitoes. They are often tamed by the Arabs."
Why were we in a plane? We were going to Basra, to the Consulate General, to collect and answer our email from Europe.
Consulate General, the office of a diplomat, who represents a country in a foreign city. Basra, a city in Iraq.
At the Consulate General, my friend's mail had arrived. But mine had not. I cabled to England, but nothing happened. After 3 days, I tried to telephone. The call had to be booked 24 hours before. When I telephoned the first day, the line was out of order. On the second, it was closed for a religious holiday. And on the third day, there was yet another breakdown. My friend left. 5 days later, the mail arrived. I carried it to my bedroom to read. I found that there were two Arabs, besides them, a sack that twisted about from time to time. They handed me a note from my friend, "Here is your otter." With the opening of that sack, began a different phase of my life. The creature that emerged from this sack on the floor, gifted by my friend, looked like a very small, medievally conceived, dragon.
Medievally conceived, as imagined in the Middle Ages.
From the head to the top of the tail, he was coated with symmetrical pointed scales of mud armor, between whose tips was visible a soft velvet fur. In a month, I managed to remove the mud and see the otter in his true colors. I named him Midgebill, or Me. In fact, the otter was of a race previously unknown to science. So, he was named by zoologists after my name,
Lutrogilperkbisolata Maxwelli,
or Maxwell's otter. On the first day, Midgebill was neither hostile, not friendly.
Hostile, unfriendly.
He was simply aloof and indifferent.
Aloof and indifferent, distant and uninterested.
He chose to sleep on the floor, as far from my bed as possible. But, the second night, he came on to my bed, in the early morning, and remained asleep in the back of my knees, until the servant brought tea in the morning. And during the day, he began to take a keen interest in his surroundings. I made a body belt for him, and took him on a lead to the bathroom.
Lead? Here, the rope connected to the body belt of a pet.
There, for half an hour, he went wild with joy in the water, plunging and rolling in it, shooting up and down the length of the bathtub underwater, and making enough splash like a hippo. This, I was to learn, is a characteristic of otters. That every drop of water must be spread about the place, a bowl must be overturned, or the otter must sit in the bowl and splash the water until it overflows. Water must be kept on the move, and when it is at rest, it is wasted and provoking.
Provoking, causing anger.
2 days later, Midgebill escaped from my bedroom as I entered it, and I turned to see his tail disappearing round the bend of the corridor that led to the bathroom. By the time I got there, he was up on the end of the bathtub, handling at the taps with his paws. I watched, amazed, that, in less than a minute, he had turned the tap far enough to produce a trickle of water, and after a moment or two, he achieved the full flow. He had been lucky to turn the tap the right way. On later occasions, he would sometimes turn it the wrong way, making it still tighter, chittering with irritation and disappointment at the tap's failure to cooperate. Very soon, Midgebill would follow me without a lead, and come to me when I called his name. Midgebill. See? He spent hours shuffling a rubber ball around the room, like a four-footed soccer player, using all 4 feet to dribble the ball. And he could also throw it, with a powerful flick of the neck, to a surprising height and distance. But the real play of an otter is, when he lies on his back, and juggles with small objects between his paws. Marbles were Mi's favorite toys for this pastime. He would lie on his back, rolling two or more of them up and down his wide, flat belly without ever dropping one to the floor. The days passed peacefully at Basra. But we had to go home. I was afraid, what would happen, when Mi will be transported to England, and from there, to Kumasferna. There was a direct flight of British Airlines, from Basra to London. But the British airline would not allow animals. So what could I do? I booked a flight to Paris on another airline, and from there, to London.
You can take your pet with you. But it should be packed into a box. Not more than 18 inches square, and it should be carried on the floor at your feet.
What? How can I put Mi in a box? I had a box made, and put Mi into the box, an hour before, so that he would become adapted to it. And then, I left for a meal in hurry. When I returned, there was a shocking scene. There was complete silence from the box, but from its air holes and chinks around the lid, blood had trickled and dried. I quickly took off the lock, and broke open the lid, and Mi, tired and drenched with blood, cried, and caught at my leg. He had torn the lining of the box, so, the box had some cutting edges. I removed all of them, so that Mi would not get hurt. I was too sorry for him, but I had no other option. The flight was just 10 minutes away, and the airport was 5 miles distant. I put him back into the box. I sat in the back of the car, with the box beside me, as the driver tore through the streets of Basra, like a ricocheting bullet.
Ricocheting bullet, a bullet which changes direction after hitting a surface.
The aircraft was waiting to take off. I was rushed through to it, by angry officials. Luckily, the seat booked for me, was at the front. I covered the floor around my feet with newspapers. I rang for the air hostess, and gave her a fish, that I had taken for Midgebill, to keep in a cool place. I shared with her all my experiences of the last hour. I had deep respect for that air hostess.
You might prefer to have the pet on your knees.
She was very queen of her kind. And, I could have kissed her hand, in the depth of my gratitude. But, not knowing otters, I was quite unprepared for what happened next. Mi was out of the box in a flash. He disappeared at high speed down the aircraft. There were squeaks and shrieks. And a woman stood up on her seat screaming out,
"A rat! A rat!"
I saw Mi's tail disappearing beneath the legs of a white turbaned Indian. I dived for it. And found my face covered in curry.
Perhaps. It would be better, if you resumed your seat, and I will find the animal, and bring it to you.
I returned to my seat. I was stretching my neck, trying to follow the hunt. When suddenly, I heard from my feet, a distressed chitter of recognition and welcome. And Mi bounded onto my knee, and began to nuzzle my face and my neck.
After an eventful journey, Maxwell and his otter reached London, where he has a flat.
Before going to Kumasferna, Midgebill and I remained in London, for nearly a month. He would play for hours with a selection of toys, ping pong balls, marbles, rubber fruit, and a terrapin shell that I had brought back from his native marshes.
Terrapin shell, turtle shell.
With the ping pong ball, he invented a game of his own, which could keep him engrossed for up to half an hour each time. A suitcase that I had taken to Iraq had become damaged on the journey back, so that the lid, when closed, remained at a slope from one end to the other. Me discovered that if he placed the ball on the high end, it would run down the length of the suitcase. He would run quickly to the other side to surprise its arrival, hide from it, bending down, to suddenly jump and grab it, and run with it to the high end once more. He would play this game for up to half an hour. Outside the house, I exercised him on a lead, as if he had been a dog. Me quickly developed certain compulsive habits on these walks in the London streets. Like the rituals of children, who, on their way to and from school, must place their feet on the center of each paving block. Must touch every seventh post of the iron railings, or pass to the outside of every second lamp post.
Maxwell says that Midgeville had some compulsive habits, like the school-going children have. The children, on their way to or from school, they step just at the center of each square block on the sidewalk. And they touch every seventh vertical rod of the fence. Just like the children had some compulsive habits, Midgeville also had acquired some. But what habits?
Opposite to my flat was a single-storied primary school, along whose frontage ran a low wall, some 2 feet high. When we would go on a walk, Midgeville would just walk with me. But, on his way back home, he would jump onto the low wall and run the full length of its 30 yards, distracting the students and teachers of the school. I think it is normal for an average Londoner to be unable to recognize an otter. It is not a common animal here. But the variety of guesses as to what kind of animal this might be came as a surprise to me. Otters belong to a comparatively small group of animals, called musthellenes. This group also consists of the badger, mongoose, weasel, stoat, mink and others. I faced a continuous barrage of conjectural questions that sprayed all the musthellenes but the otter.
He faced a continuous barrage of conjectural questions. What does this mean? Barrage, stream. Conjectural, assuming. Means, he faced a constant stream of assuming questions about the animal. The Londoners made guesses about what animal it was. The guesses aimed at all the musthellenes, but not the otter.
More random guesses hit on a baby seal and a squirrel. And,
is that a walrus, mister?
Some guessed, a hippo, a beaver, a bear cub, a leopard that has changed its spots. And, a brontosaur. Me was anything but an otter. But the question, for which I awarded the highest score, came from a laborer digging a hole in the street. I was still far from him when he laid down his tool, put his hands on his hips, and began to stare. As I approached, I could see the surprise and slight anger on his face, as if he wanted me to understand that he wasn't someone to be laughed at. I came near. He spat and growled.
Here, mister. Here, mister. Here. What is that supposed to be?
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 What is that?
If you found this video useful, please like the video and share it with your friends. All of them. And subscribe my channel for more such animations of Class 10.